The world of folklore is teeming with tales of mysterious creatures that inhabit remote wilderness. From North America's Bigfoot to the Himalaya's Yeti, these legends capture our imaginations. However, the story of Zana, a female creature resembling Bigfoot captured in the Caucasus in the late 19th century, stands as a unique case where recorded history intertwines with fantastical tales. Was she a mythical creature? A descendant of archaic humans like Neanderthals? Or something else entirely? In this episode, we delve into the mystery of her true identity, as revealed by recent DNA research. Written accounts about ape-like creatures inhabiting forests in the Caucasus are traced in time as far back as the 10th century. Almost every ethnic group in the region has tales of encounters with such beings. Legends claim these creatures inhabited the region long before humans arrived, but their numbers dwindled due to conquest wars over living space, and they were driven into desolate areas. Yet numerous accounts have been recorded of more recent encounters, occasional killings by hunters, and of their being caught and tamed with subsequent living in captivity in noblemen's households. While names given to the creatures vary across the region's languages, they all translate roughly to man of the woods, wild man, or hairy man. In Russia, they are commonly known as almasty. Zana's story exemplifies such encounters. According to such stories, Zana was a female almasty who was captured, tamed, and lived among humans until her death in the 1880s or 1890s. Even when zoologists visited the village in 1962, Zana's story was still very much alive, remembered by many villagers in their 80s and older. While details may vary slightly depending on the source, let's begin by telling the widely known story of Zana. Details of her capture, such as the date and location, remain vague. According to one account, she was captured in the Zana forest in Abkhazia, northwestern Georgia, sometime in the 1870s. Hunters purportedly tracked her down and used age-old techniques to lure in a trap and counter her furious fighting. She was subdued only after several strong male hunters repeatedly pounded her with cudgels, gagged her mouth with felt, and shackled her legs to a log. After being sold multiple times as a slave, she was presented to a nobleman, Adv Genet, who took her, still shackled and chained, to his estate. It was there she was given the name Zana. Zana's physical appearance was striking. At nearly 2 meters tall, she was massively broad, with huge breasts and buttocks, muscular arms and legs, and fingers that were longer and thicker than ordinary human fingers. Her skin was black or dark gray, and her whole body was covered with reddish-black hair, except for her face, feet, and palms. The hair on her head was tousled and thick, hanging mane-like down her back. She had a flattened nose with turned-out large nostrils and a snout-like prognathic lower part of the face with high cheekbones, muzzle-like jaws, a wide mouth with large white teeth. These teeth were so strong that she easily cracked the hardest walnuts. But the most terrifying was her facial expression, which was purely animal, not human. The locals described her as being part human and part animal. Zana, stripped of her freedom, was subjected to unimaginable hardship. For the first 3 years, she was confined in a cage, for she acted like a wild beast. Villagers, understandably curious, flocked to see the captive, some even going so far as to cruelly taunt and poke her with sticks. No one dared to venture in, and food was simply thrown to her. 3 years later, as she gradually became calmer, she was released from the cage and moved to a wattle fence enclosure under an awning away from the house. Initially tethered, she was eventually allowed to roam freely. Yet she never went far from the place where she was accustomed to receiving her food. She could not tolerate warm rooms and stayed outdoors all year around, sleeping in a hole that she made herself under the awning. In the summertime, she liked to lie in a cool pool side by side with buffaloes. She swam in the cold mountain river and preferred to walk naked even in winter. She was given dresses, but she tore everything off except for the loincloth. At night she used to roam the surrounding hills. She wielded big sticks against dogs and on other perilous occasions. Zana had a curious obsession for playing with stones, knocking one against another and splitting them. Women were afraid of her and came near only when she was in a peaceful mood. When angry, she presented a scary sight and could even bite, but in general did not show unprovoked aggressiveness toward villagers. Parents used Zana as a bogeyman to scare their children. "Now get to bed or Zana, the monster, will get you." Although Zana never actually attacked children. Despite living among humans for decades, Zana never learned to speak. She only made inarticulate sounds and mutterings, and cries when irritated. However, she did understand her name and could perform simple domestic tasks, like striking fire from flint onto tinder and fanning it, turning hand millstones, bringing home firewood and water, carrying sacks to and from the watermill, or pulling her master's high boots off. Unbelievably, she lived for years without any signs of aging. No graying hair, no falling teeth, keeping strong and fit as ever. Her strength was legendary. She could run faster than a horse and swim across the wild river, even when it violently rose in high tide. Without any effort, she could lift an 80-kilogram sack of flour with one hand and carry it up the hill from the mill to the village. As clumsy as a bear, she could still climb trees with ease to pick fruit. She would even pull down the whole vine growing around the tree to eat its grapes to her heart's content. She ate whatever was offered to her, including hominy and meat, with bare hands and enormous gluttony. Intriguingly, Zana is reported to have experienced multiple pregnancies and childbirth. The exact circumstances leading to these pregnancies remain unclear, but there are stories that she was given alcohol by local men and then sexually assaulted while intoxicated. According to the local stories, Zana gave birth without assistance and washed her newborns in the ice-cold water of a local spring. Tragically, this resulted in the death of both her first and second child. Upon realizing this, the villagers decided that if Zana were to have any more children, they would take the newborn away immediately and raise it themselves. Zana subsequently gave birth to four more children, but they were all immediately taken from her care and raised by the villagers. The adopted children grew up to become active members of the local society, all married in time, and had their own children. Zana's eldest son, Janda, had about 9 daughters and died between 1930 and 1940 and was buried in the village of Pakbeshi in Abkhazia. The eldest daughter of Zana was Gamasa, who had a son and a daughter. She died in 1925 at the age of approximately 60 years and was buried in the Janaba family cemetery. The second daughter, Kodzinar, also had 2 daughters. The date and place of her death remains unknown. The youngest son, Khwit, married twice and had 1 daughter, Tanya from the first marriage, and daughter Raya and son, Shaliko, from the second marriage. Khwit died in 1954 at the age of 65 to 70 years and was buried in the Geneva family cemetery. Rumor had it that both Gamasa and Khwit were sired by Edgy Janaba, which explains their final resting places in the Janaba family cemetery. Many witnesses in the village remembered and could describe very well both Gamasa and Khwit. Both were very strongly built, but otherwise inherited rather little of mother's facial appearance. According to the locals, Gamasa was about twice as stronger than an average male, had a very dark skin and noticeable hypertrichosis. Khwit also had a darker than usual skin and larger lips than usual for the local population. Otherwise, he was described by his fellow villagers as little different from the average villager. He was extremely strong, difficult to deal with, and quick to pick a fight. In one of such fights with his fellow villagers, he lost his right hand. Yet his left hand sufficed him to mow and do other work on a collective farm, and even climb trees. Anyway, we'll never know if Zana ever had the chance to see her children flourish into admirable adults. Around 1890, Zana died. She had spent nearly two decades as a captive, subjected to forced labor, succumbing to alcoholism, and without any family by her side. Decades after Zana's death, researchers were intrigued by the enduring folklore surrounding her and sought to uncover the truth about Zana. However, for a long time, no one knew for sure where Zana was buried. Some believed she was buried in the Janaba family cemetery, while others claimed she was buried in the village cemetery. Researchers attempted to locate her burial site in the 1960s and 1970s, but without success. The years that followed only deepened the mystery. When archaeologists unearthed the skull of Zana's son, Khwit, the puzzle pieces seemed to scatter further. Khwit's skull was significantly larger than the average Abkhazian male and exhibited unique characteristics that blended modern and archaic features. This fueled a firestorm of speculation about Zana's origins, with some even dared to suggest she might be a descendant of Neanderthals, a hominin species that vanished over 40,000 years ago. However, despite numerous theories, no definitive evidence has been found. In 2021, Zana's story took a dramatic turn. Advancements in ancient DNA analysis led to a groundbreaking discovery. A study titled The Genomic Origin of Zana of Abkhazia employed these techniques to analyze DNA from the remains of Zana's son, Khwit, and an unidentified female found nearby. The researchers confirmed a clear mother-son relationship, revealing that the unidentified remains belonged to Zana herself. This discovery finally brought to light the long-held mystery of Zana's enigmatic origins. Zana was neither a mythical being nor a Neanderthal. She was just like us, human. The results clearly showed that Zana was not genetically close to archaic humans or chimpanzees, but rather closely related to modern human populations. And surprisingly, Zana was of African descent. Further analysis revealed her closest genetic relatives within Africa to be East African populations, particularly the Luo and Luhya peoples. Moreover, a maternally inherited mitochondrial DNA analysis shows that both Zana and Khwit carry haplogroup L2B, a genetic marker prevalent across Africa. However, Khwit's genetic makeup falls between that of Caucasian and African populations. This is consistent with historical accounts suggesting his father was a local Abkhazian man. His Y chromosome belongs to haplogroup R1b, a paternal lineage commonly found in Europe and West Asia, further supporting this conclusion. While the discovery answers one question, it raises another. How did an African woman end up living wild in the foothills of the Caucasus Mountains? Researchers point to the existence of the Afro-Abkhazians as a clue. This small ethnic group is spread across the Black Sea coast of the Caucasus, predominantly inhabiting the rural village of Ajubza and its surrounding villages in Abkhazia. Their historic origins are still a matter of dispute. One hypothesis suggests that in the 17th century, the Georgian ruling family of the Principality of Abkhazia purchased hundreds of slaves and brought them to the region to work on citrus plantations. Another theory proposes that Afro-Abkhazians arrived via unknown routes from Ethiopia. There is also a legend that Peter the Great imported many Africans into Russia. Those who could not adapt to the harsh St. Petersburg climate were subsequently sent as gifts to Abkhazian princes, supposedly becoming the ancestors of the modern Afro-Abkhazian population. Researchers speculate that Zana could be one of such slaves or their descendants who escaped and became feral living in forest wilderness. But why did the villagers depict Zana as a hairy beast? All eyewitnesses consistently stated that Zana did not look like sub-Saharan Africans. On the contrary, they described her as a hairy beast in an animal-like state. Based on these descriptions, researchers hypothesized that Zana may have suffered from a genetic disorder called hypertrichosis. This condition causes excessive hair growth all over the body. They speculate that her unfamiliar physical characteristics and the rumors that persisted for generations thereafter may have fueled the myth of her non-human origins. Zana's story serves as an unforgettable lesson in the cruelty humans can inflict upon the unknown. By revealing her true origins, we have come to recognize Zana not as a mythical creature, but as a human being who endured a life of hardship. DNA analysis has the power to rewrite history and challenge long-held assumptions. Zana's case serves as a reminder that there are countless untold stories waiting to be unearthed.
It's Mr. Pond.